गुड इवनिंग.
गुड इवनिंग मैम।
या सो वील कंटिन्यू विद द क्लासिकल कंडीशनिंग. नाउ टेल मी व्हाट एवर यू अंडरस्टूड अबाउट क्लासिकल कंडीशनिंग सो दैट आई विल रिपीट इन दैट इंटेंसिटी. आशीष डिड यू अंडरस्टैंड एनीथिंग क्लासिकल कंडीशनिंग एनीथिंग
लिटिल बिट
प्लीज प्लीज Place your
A
mind.
little bit.
Little bit. Just explain to me whatever you understood in your own words. No big terms. Just explain what is classical conditioning, or how is classical conditioning, or can you explain the experiment done by Ivan Pavlov? Anything that we learned in the last class.
He used a dog for this purpose.
He used a dog for this purpose. Very good. Then.
At the beginning, the bell was neutral. Then she used a salivating tube.
Surgery was done and a tube was attached to collect the saliva and measure the saliva. A jar was kept to measure the saliva of the dog. Then, in the second phase of the experiment, what happened? A bell was introduced.
Bell was introduced. When bell rang, he gave food to the dog.
Food
to the dog.
Okay.
This process repeated again and again. Then once he bell
rang the bell.
Rang the bell. No food.
No food. Not food.
Food.
In the movie Pachakudra. And that the second role of Dilip tells no food, mama food, you tell like that, okay?
Yeah.
Food. Okay, food. Yeah.
So the rung make tempted him to have the food.
So what was the response from the dog in all these cases?
Happy.
Boy, what response are we learning here?
Conditional.
Conditioned response, unconditioned response, all that is okay. What is the example here for the conditioned and unconditioned response?
The dog's experiment.
Dogs?
Experiment.
Dog's experiment. That also I understood. Okay, leave all that. Why did he attach the tube? Why did he do the surgery and attach the tube to the dog?
Don't know if saliva is coming or not.
Okay, so what is the actual response from the dog to the food and the bell?
Producing saliva.
Producing saliva or secreting saliva. Okay. So earlier what happened? Yes, Ashish, very good. And not food, it's food. Okay? From now on, it's food. Okay, Elvina, can you explain that experiment once more? Step by step, not step by step, in that correct order.
Yes, ma'am. Ivan Paolo has conducted an experiment by a dog. He put the dog in a box and...
Continue.
In a kettle. And he connected a tube at his jaw and one tube at the jaw and on the end of the tube at the jar or a container to collect the salivation.
No problem. We have ample time left. Okay.
To collect the salivation. And he had kept a glass in front of the dog. Behind the door, they had kept a plate. There was also a bell kept in the kettle. When the bell rings, the plate has been food like meat powder. And it also repeated again and again. When the bell rings, the dog knows that it is food. Then he started salivated again and again.
again to the what? Salivate well or the food?
To the food.
Earlier he salivated only to, he or she salivated only to the food, and then later on what happened?
Later, when the bell rings, he doesn't see any food, but also he salivated.
Why? To what did he salivate?
To the bell, when the bell rings.
Yes. Okay. This was the experiment. So, classical conditioning means the learning in which the association is found between two stimulus. Which are the two stimulus here? What is a stimulus basically? Anything that gives us a response. That is a stimulus. Which are the two stimulus here? The response from the dog side was salivation. To what all stimulus or stimuli did the dog give the response?
The food and the bell.
Food and the bell. And the bell earlier when Ivan Pavlov rang the bell, the dog did not salivate. Okay. So at that time, at the beginning of the experiment, this bell was known as the neutral stimulus. Okay. And later on, the bell was paired. It was associated. It was presented along with the food. Okay. That is why this dog started to salivate to the bell. And again, before the experiment, the food was given, the dog would salivate. So that is an automatic response. For humans also, when we see food, we salivate. That is again an automatic or reflexive response. So that, both those things that were, what is this, Ashish, trying to scare us? Okay, so the, what does it telling? Ashish, you know, yeah, the unconditioned stimulus, that is the food there. Because there is no condition, there hasn't been any conditioning taken place. Before the conditioning itself, the dog salivates to the food. So food is the unconditioned stimulus, and salivation to the food is the unconditioned response. Okay. And after conditioning, what happened is we finished all the conditioning process. The bell was rung, the food was given, the salivation happened. The bell was rung, the food was given, the salivation happened. So later on, the bell was rung, food was not given, and salivation happened. So salivation happened as a response to what stimulus? What was the stimulus there?
Bell.
So the dog salivated to the bell at the end of the experiment. So the bell is the conditioned stimulus, and the salivation to the bell is the conditioned response. Understood? Now clear? Anybody, if anybody has a doubt, ask me, or should I explain once more? Abraham Lijesh, who's that? Any doubt, ask me. Ashish, understood a little bit more?
Completely understood.
Completely understood. Okay. Amal, any doubt? No. Raina, any doubt?
Ma'am, can you explain once more?
Explain once more. Okay, I'll make one of you explain once more. Who knows? Who understood it very well? Yes? Who understood it very well? Who can explain? Nobody? Then you told you understood everything. Grishma, did you understand?
I didn't hear a part of it the first.
I can't hear.
I didn't hear some part of it.
You didn't hear last part of it. Hmm. Okay. Who heard the whole part? Aishwarya, come on.
Is it about the unconditioned and conditioned stimuli?
Deshma, is it that? Yeah.
So in the unconditioned stimuli comes the food and the salivation. So unconditioned stimuli and response happens before the classical conditioning.
Hmm.
Before the conditioning, the dog only salivated when the food was there and the bell was not a part of it. It was a neutral stimuli.
Bell was neutral stimulus.
So it is known as unconditioned stimuli and unconditioned response. Unconditioned stimulus is the food and the response is the salivation.
Salivation to the food. Okay, before the experiment, the normal response of people. Like I gave you the example of the lunch break, no? So when you see the food or when you think about the food, you salivate. That is a normal response. So that is the unconditioned stimulus and the unconditioned response of humans. Just like that, the dog also salivated to the food that was presented earlier. So again, that is the unconditioned stimulus and unconditioned response. Okay, continue.
The conditioned stimuli and conditioned response happens after conditioning. That is, there the bell also becomes a stimuli. So the unconditioned stimuli becomes the food and the bell. Yeah. Is it just the bell?
Yeah, it is the bell.
It is the bell, and then the response is salivation.
Salivation to the bell.
The bell.
Okay, earlier the salivation was to the food. Now the dog learned. We are learning about learning. No, this is a principle of learning. Classical condition is a principle of learning. So the dog learned that when the bell rings, he'll automatically get food. Okay, so he associated the bell with the food. This association is the theme of classical conditioning. Pairing or association. That is the theme of classical conditioning. Okay. The learning of association, the learning of association between one stimulus and the next stimulus. In page number 110, you have all these bold letters, US, CS, CR, UR, all those things. And the last, that is the right side, first paragraph, and towards the end, you have, it is obvious that the learning situation in classical conditioning is one of SS learning, in which one stimulus, example, sound of bell, becomes a signal for another stimulus, example, food. Here, one stimulus signifies the possible occurrence of another stimulus. Understood? So, one stimulus comes, it signals, or it is associated or paired with another stimulus, which is the food here, the bell and the food. It was paired together. Now imagine we are doing the same experiment, but we don't have a bell with us. So instead we bring a drum or we bring a light, a bright light. So when the light is on, then we provide the food and the dog salivates. So again, when the light is on, the food is provided, the dog salivates. Finally, we don't need the food. When the light is on itself, the dog starts to salivate. Understood? So in that case, which will be the conditioned stimulus, Ashish?
Drum.
Drum or the light. Okay, that will be the unconditioned stimulus. And what will be the unconditioned response, Amal?
Salivation
to what? To the drum or the food? I'm asking about the conditioned response.
Towards
the light or the drum, correct. So you have understood at least something? Okay, go home, read the topic and come tomorrow. And you have a homework today. Find one daily life example. You can create the experiment or you can create some weird experiments like our Pavlo. Please don't take any dog examples. Take cat or whatever you are. Please don't take any dogs. Okay. You find out one example from your daily life situation, or you can create an experiment and explain tomorrow. Okay. Can you do that? We'll spend some 5 or 10 minutes tomorrow for the new examples. Fine. Okay, deal. Okay. Now we'll move on to the determinants of classical conditioning. Write down the determinants of classical conditioning. Okay, write down the headings first and then I'll explain. The first one is time relations between stimuli. Time relations between stimuli. Time relations between stimuli. Elvina, read that. So these are the factors influencing classical conditioning. Okay, the determinants of classical conditioning. Okay, start.
Time relations between stimuli. The classical conditioning procedures discussed below are basically of four types based on the time relations between the onset of conditioned stimulus and unconditioned stimulus. The first three are called forward conditioning procedures and the fourth one is called backward conditioning procedure. Mm. The basic experimental arrangements of these procedures are as follows.
Wait. So, time relations between stimuli, which means that we have two types of stimulus in classical conditioning. Which are they? Two types of stimuli. Which are they? Meghna?
Unconditioned
and conditioned stimuli. So, the time basis, when is the onset of the conditioned stimulus? When is the onset of the unconditioned stimulus? Based on that, we have four types of conditioning. Okay. And the first three that we are going to discuss belongs to the category of forward conditioning, which means that usual methods that we discuss now, that is, which is presented first, the unconditioned stimulus or the conditioned stimulus? In the classic Pavlov experiment, which one was presented first?
Unconditioned.
Unconditioned.
I'm asking about the process of conditioning, okay? I didn't tell that the answer you told is wrong. I want you to be confident in your answer. Think about it. Don't shoot. Okay. I'm talking about the conditioning procedure. Okay. We have to condition the dog into this. We have to make the dog learn a new thing. In that process, in that step or in that phase of the experiment, which is presented first, the unconditioned stimulus or the conditioned stimulus? Or I'll give you another option to say, the bell or the food?
The food.
I want to hear everybody's answer. Elvina, what do you say?
Bell.
Amal.
The food.
Food. Not food, the food. Raina?
Bell.
Ashish.
Food.
Food. Okay. Meghna. Huh?
Food.
Food. Grishma.
Bell.
Bell. Okay. Whoever said food, hands up. Ashish said food. Okay. Who else said bell? Reina, Elvina and Grishma. Okay. Will we give the food, then ring the bell and then see the salivation? Or we'll ring the bell, then give the food and observe the salivation? How is it? Huh? Food people, tell me.
Food before salivation.
Eh? So, which is the first? Aishwarya.
I'm confused.
Confused. Okay, I told you, we ring the bell, we provide the food, then observe the salivation. Okay, first is the bell, then comes the food. Otherwise, if we give the food, then dog will already start salivating you. Yes or no? So we can't know whether this is because of the food or the bell. So we ring the bell, then we suggest that the food is upcoming. Okay. Then only we observe the salivation. So it is the bell first, then comes the food, then comes the salivation. Understood? Okay. So this process is known as the forward conditioning. That is the conditioned stimulus, the unconditioned stimulus and the response. this flow is known as a forward conditioning. Now backward conditioning will be the food, the bell, and the other thing, response, observing the response. So we have first three as the forward conditioning. They are the simultaneous, delayed, and trace conditioning. Three types: simultaneous, delay, and trace conditioning. They are the types of forward conditioning. Okay, the first one is simultaneous conditioning. In that, the CS and US are presented together simultaneously. That is, if we consider the dog experiment, the food and the bell, they are presented together. Okay, see the bell and the food together in both the hands, we can give to the dog. That is a type of conditioning, a type of forward conditioning. It is called simultaneous conditioning. Now the second one, in delayed conditioning, what happens? Meghna, please read.
In delayed conditioning, the onset of CS precedes the onset of US. The CS ends before the end of the US.
Okay, it is delayed conditioning, which means there is a delay in the stopping of the conditioned stimulus. That means the onset of CS, that is the conditioned stimulus, precedes the onset of US. Obviously, in forward conditioning, always it precedes the unconditioned stimulus. That is, the bell precedes the food all the time in forward conditioning. So, the CS ends before the end of US. That is the delay. That is, I start ringing the bell, okay, and the food is given. The bell is still continued. And just before this dog finishes the food, only I stop the bell. Okay? So, for a delayed period of time, I still keep on ringing the bell. That is delayed conditioning. In the usual normal method, what do we do? We just ring the bell, stop it, then give the food, and then see the response. In simultaneous conditioning, what do? We provide the bell and the food together, and then we see the response in the dog. And the second one is delayed conditioning. I keep on ringing the bell. I take out food. I provide it to the dog. Just before the dog finishes the food, I stop ringing the bell. Okay, that is delayed conditioning. Now the next one is trace conditioning. Amal, read.
In trace conditioning, the onset and the end of the CS precedes the onset of US with some times gap between the two.
Okay, the onset of end of the conditioned stimulus precedes the onset of unconditioned stimulus with some time gap between the two. Understood anything? Anyone? Elvina, did you understand?
No, ma'am.
Read it once more, everyone. Read those words once more. It is trace conditioning. Means it leaves a trace. The onset and the end of the CS precedes the onset of US with some time gap between the two. Okay, just replace the US and CS with the food and the bell and see if you can understand. So you can read it as the onset and end of the conditioned stimulus, which is the bell. Okay, the onset and end of the bell precedes the onset of US. What is it? The food. With some time gap between the two. So the onset and the end means conditioned stimulus, which is the bell, it starts and ends. Starting and ending of the bell precedes the onset of unconditioned stimulus, which is the food, with some time gap between the two. Now understood? Anybody who understood? Actually understood, tell.
First the bell would be ringed, then after some time the food would be provided.
Yes, that's it. it leaves a trace. The bell leaves a trace. That is why this is known as trace conditioning. That is, I start the ringing the bell, I stop it. Then after a few seconds or a few minutes, I give the food. This is trace conditioning. From the name itself, you can identify. There is a trace left by the condition stimulus. That is a bell. Okay, that is trace conditioning. So these are the types of forward conditioning. Now we have one more type, that is backward conditioning. Backward conditioning, the opposite of forward conditioning. Forward conditioning, which comes first again? US or CS? Unconditioned stimulus or conditioned stimulus? Which comes first in forward conditioning? Raina, which comes first?
US, unconditional stimulus.
US, what is US in the experiment that we discussed?
US, like food.
Food. Food comes first in the forward conditioning?
Yeah.
Okay, whenever you get the US and CS, you'll confuse it. So, relate it with the food and bell and C. Okay. Otherwise, you'll just go upside down, topsy-turvy. Everything will be, if you just make a mistake in this US and CS, then the whole answer will be wrong. Okay, and you lose almost 6 or 4 marks at just because of that simple mistake. Okay, so backward conditioning, what happens is just the ulta. That is, the unconditioned stimulus is provided first and then the conditioned stimulus comes. That is, the food is provided first and then the bell is given, the bell is rung. So you might ask me then, why is it not done earlier? I told you that the conditioning might not take place. But in certain situations, this is possible, but it's very rare. Okay, the chances of the conditioning happening is very rare. Understood? Okay, so that's about the first one, time relations between stimuli. That was between the time relations between the conditioned stimulus and the unconditioned stimulus. We had three types of forward conditioning, one backward conditioning. In forward conditioning, we had simultaneous conditioning, delayed conditioning, trace conditioning. And the last one, backward conditioning, in which the US, that is food, is provided first, then the bell is rung, then the response is observed. Fine. Shall we move on to the second point? Yeah. Second point is type of unconditioned stimuli. Who will read? Grishma, can you read?
Type of unconditioned stimuli.
Mm.
The unconditioned stimuli used in studies of classical conditioning are basically of two types, that is appetitive and aversive. Appetitive unconditioned stimuli automatically elicits approach responses such as eating, drinking, caressing, etc. These responses give satisfaction and pleasure. On the other hand, aversive US such as noise, bitter taste, electric shock, painful injections, etc. are painful, harmful, and elicit avoidance and escape responses. It has been found that appetitive classical conditioning is slower and requires greater number of acquisition trials. But aversive classical conditioning is established in 1, 2, or 3 trials depending on the intensity of the aversive.
Okay. Appetitive unconditioned stimulus and aversive unconditioned stimulus. Which is the unconditioned stimulus in our experiment, Amal? Unconditioned stimulus. Unconditioned means it's not not yet conditioned. Which is it? The food or the bell? Don't eat the headset. Tell which is the unconditioned stimulus.
Ma'am.
Unconditioned stimulus, which means automatic response happens for it. It's not conditioned.
And the bell.
Ah.
Yeah.
Since it's the first class, it's okay. But after 2-3 days, if you say the same thing, no, I'll search your address from the office and I'll just come to your house.
Yeah.
Mind that. The unconditioned stimulus means the stimulus that gets the usual response. Unconditioned response, which is the food. When we see the food, we salivate. Conditioned, see that word, no? From that word itself, you can understand. Conditioned stimulus, which means we have conditioned the dog to the this particular thing. What? The bell. We have conditioned the dog. We have already set the dog in such a way that he responds to this particular thing. Okay. So the conditioned stimulus is the bell and the unconditioned stimulus is the food. Okay, so there are two types of unconditioned stimuli, appetitive and aversive. Okay, appetitive means something that satisfies our biological needs, like food, then some hug from us. We need the attachment, no? Attachment, we learned the physical comfort, all those are our biological needs. So the hug that we get from our parents or elders or whatever, that can be an appetitive unconditioned stimulus. Then water that satisfies our thirst, that can be an appetitive unconditioned stimulus. Now aversive means the all the bad things, the electric shocks, the injections that we get, all these things can be the aversive unconditioned stimuli. Okay, there are two types. So based on the type of unconditioned stimuli, the classical conditioning can differ. And it is generally considered that aversive stimuli, they are the ones which increase the amount of what? Classical conditioning than the appetitive ones. Okay. Generally, it is found that aversive ones are the ones, are the stimuli that increase the amount of classical conditioning than the appetitive ones. That's about the type of unconditioned stimuli. Now we have third one, intensity of conditioned stimuli. Intensity of CS. Earlier we saw types of US. Okay, now we have the intensity of CS. Read, Raina, read that. This influences
the course of both appetitive and aversive classical conditioning. More intense stimuli are more effective in accelerating an acquisition of conditional responses. It means that the more intense, the more conditioned stimulus, the fewer are the number of acquisition trails needed for the conditioning.
Okay, so in our experiment, if there was only a mild sound of the bell, imagine in one situation, there's only a mild sound of the bell, we provide the food and we see the salivation. And in another situation, we give a very loud sound of the bell, then we give the food and then we observe the salivation. So it is generally considered that the loud sound with high intensity, that is the one that that results in the proper conditioning or more easier conditioning. Okay, high intensity of the stimulus, conditioned stimulus of the CS, high intensity of CS has to be there in order to get conditioned in less amount of trials and less amount of time. Okay, so high intensity of the stimulus, conditioned stimulus might save our time and our effort and our money and all those things. Okay. That is about the determinants of classical conditioning. Any doubt? Any doubt until now? It's a new topic. Go read, go read, go read and do the homework and come. Okay, see the video if you want in the YouTube. That will help you. For the visual learners, that will help you a lot. And yes, any doubt? Ask me now. So let me tell you, and I told you that we'll replace the bell with the light, no? So what do you think, a high intensity light or a low intensity light, which will fasten the process of conditioning?
High intensity.
intensity light because of the third determinant of classical conditioning, that is intensity of conditioned stimuli. Okay, please don't tell me that you forgot to do the homework. Please do that and come tomorrow. Okay, fine, we'll meet tomorrow then. If you have any doubt, please read up the topic also, and any doubt please mark and keep, or you can text me or call me or whatever, or ask me tomorrow. Fine. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.